sentence, but committed no crime. And bad mistakes, I've made a few. I've had my shells and kicked in my face, but I've come through. And I need to go home.
Unofficial national anthem for the Stanley Cup winning New York Islanders from 1980 to 1984, or 83, I should say. Of course, they went to the Stanley Cup Finals in 1984, lost to the Edmonton Oilers, but they won 19 series in a row.
They were a beat-up team by the finals.
They were, but, you know, 19 series in a row will not be topped by any team ever. Maybe the greatest, what's the word I'm looking for? Greatest
accomplishment, achievement?
No. I'm thinking of.
I don't know what your ordeal going for.
I don't know what I'm going for, but the greatest, not monopoly. What's the word?
Dynasty.
I couldn't think of the word for a second. And it's one time captain has passed. Clark Gilles, Hall of Famer. Not just the Islander Hall of Fame, but the NHL Hall of Fame. They retired his number also, the Islanders. He died last week at the age of 67, brother. So young.
Very young. Very sad.
Very sad. Nicknamed Jethro, which I never really heard him called Jethro by other teammates, but when he first got here, they called him Jethro. Could be because he was born in Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, in Canada. And
there's a story there. And I was trying to get Pat Calera. I didn't want to leave with this, brother, because I wanted to talk football first and then hopefully get Pat Calera on.
Get on that mic for a second, brother.
To give us some stories.
Right.
And to, you know, kind of let people know just, you know, how funny a guy Clark Gilles was.
Oh, yeah.
Because there's one story. I'll give you one story, brother. One quickie story. Was that... He was asked where is Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, because that's where he's from. Obviously, obviously, a very colorfully named town.
Right.
Well, and there are a few of those like in Canada, like Medicine Hat, Alberta.
Love that name.
And King City in Ontario, which is actually right outside of Toronto. But somebody said, Clark, where is Moose Jaw? And he said, about 6 feet in front of the moose's ass.
Wow, yeah, he you know what?
I wonder how many times he used that line.
Oh, I'm sure he used it a lot.
Hundreds or thousands.
He died this past week, of course. When he came to the Islanders back in 1974, first-round draft pick, fourth pick overall, just shows how great Bill Torrey was in that early part of the draft in the mid-70s, which led to the dynasty in the early 80s.
He was the fourth overall selection in that draft, which, you know, tells like a lot of people thought, people who were a little clueless or maybe didn't know the Islanders so well, but they thought, oh, well, Gilles, he's just the muscle on that line. Because you had Mike Bossy, sniper, really didn't care a whole lot about playing defense. And then you had Brian Trottier, who was just outstanding on both sides of the puck.
Yep.
You know, tough guy, dude, wasn't going to take any crap from anybody, but... The Islanders needed him on the ice. He was a wonderfully creative player, made stuff happen, whether it was with skill or with toughness and just barreling into people. But he was the guy that made that line go.
Yep.
So Gilles had to be, you know, part enforcer, part, you know, guy who's parking himself in front of him. He basically, you know, the term power forward came about, and he really kind of was one of the originals in that role, because that's what he did. He wasn't just a guy who was going to, you know, beat guys up, and obviously he had the very famous and celebrated fights against Terry O'Reilly, and we'll go into that a little bit later, because I want to try and get Pat Calabria on the phone. But that, you know, his role was everything, and he scored goals, and he was a really outstanding player in his own right.
And it allowed... You know, if you think about it, because he was so big, he was 6'3", which back in the mid-70s was huge. The players
that was a big dude. Now
he'd be kind of small.
Now he'd just be average size. Yeah. You know? I mean, not everybody's a Dano Chara.
Right. But the thing about Gillies that I think people forget, people think that the Islanders had Bossy first, and they said, oh, he's our goal scorer. We need a guy to protect him. It was the other way around.
It's the other way around.
Gillies comes in first, and then Bossy comes later on.
Mm-hmm.
So, and, you know, if you think about it, this guy was on one of the great lines ever, and he's the third guy. And if you think about it, all three are in the Hall of Fame, which you don't normally see.
Well, and I mean, it clearly it was the best line in Islander history, probably by far. And it was, as far as I'm concerned, one of the best lines in NHL history.
Yeah, that's what I said.
There was very few lines that I would say would match up with them. I mean, you had the French Connection line up in Buffalo, which was outstanding.
Right.
I'm sure the Canadians probably could put a couple lines together.
Gilbert, Hatfield, and Jean Rattel was
with the Rangers. Yeah. That was an outstanding line. Didn't really help him at all, but an outstanding line.
Jean Rattel broke his ankle, and Gilbert always said if he didn't do that, we would have won the Stanley Cup. And he's now what? He's got a point. You know, he's got a point.
He's a maybe. You know, yeah. Hey, injuries happen.
Yeah,
part of careers.
So anyway, so he had 319 goals, 378 assists, 697 with the points. His last season was with Buffalo. Only played 25 games. He was actually 2 years with the Buffalo.
Yeah, he played
Sabres.
two seasons with Buffalo.
Yeah, and just hard to believe, you know. And they didn't say why he died.
Yeah, there was no cause. Yeah. Which is, I think the fans would like to know. I mean, I'm assuming there's got to be a reason why.
At 67. Every time you saw him, he's, you know, except for the gray hair, he looks basically the same.
He looked good. Yeah. And I have to say, for anybody who might not know. I don't think anybody expected Gillies to be the first one out of that line. Mike Bossy was diagnosed with lung cancer a month or two ago, and his prognosis is not good.
I don't know if it happened without the Islanders knowing, but there was a post right about the same time the announcement for Gillies was saying that Mike Bossy is recuperating from cancer.
Right.
Which I didn't know about.
Yeah,
I know that, but I didn't know about that he was going through cancer.
Yeah, no, they announced it about a month or two ago. Yeah. It might have been sometime in December. I don't remember exactly when it was. But I remember, you know, on one hand, you're shocked by it because it's anytime somebody says, well, I have cancer, it's jarring news. But to hear it from Mike Bossy, it wasn't necessarily a surprise. Because besides being an elite athlete, the guy was a chain smoker.
Yeah,
he would smoke in between periods.
Yeah, well,
I mean, it was he smoked way too much, and people told him constantly throughout his career, Mike, you got to give those things up, and he never did. And so when you heard lung cancer, it's like, oh, damn it, you know, and you don't want him to have it, but again, it's not a surprise that it happened.
Well, I always think, and just to jump over to Bossy for a second, I still remember at one point Bossy saying, well, I'm not going to play over the age of 30. And he didn't. He basically, his back
gave out. Well, his back gave out. That was why. Because that was back in the day when the refs really would let him play. And you really, Mike Bossy took so many cross checks to the back.
You remember Turn 'Em Loose Bruce?
Oh,
God. Yeah.
There was so many just, I mean, I don't even want to call them bad referees because they refereed for the time.
Yeah, they did.
And that's what it was.
I mean, there was only three people on the ice. Now there's four.
You got to protect your players.
Well, that's one thing Gillies did. Gillies.
Well, it's not the refs have to do
it,
too.
I know that, but Gillies' job was anyone who came near Mike Bossy that you were going to get, you know, something from Clark Gilles.
If nothing else, Clark Gilles was going to skate past you and growl a little bit and say, yeah, hey, remember me? I'm still here.
Yep.
Don't mess with my boys.
Yep, and that's what he did. And, you know, him and Nystrom had, you know, and Gary Howard, when he was around, had some of the best fights ever.
Oh, I saw it. What was the story? It was a Ranger. I don't even remember which Ranger it was. But Herb Brooks, I saw this. It was one of the tribute stories. Herb Brooks sent him out to fight with Gillies. And I don't remember what it was. It wasn't like a real fighter kind of guy.
Right.
But he said he came out, charged up to Gillies, drops the gloves, and Gillies laughed at him. He said, dude, I'm not fighting you. And so he goes back to the bench, and Herb Brooks says to him, he goes, what happened? He goes, he laughed at me. He says, I'm beneath him. And he's like, yeah. So Herb Brooks tells him, he goes, all right, go fight Nystrom then. Well, Bob Nystrom didn't think he was beneath him and kicked the crap out of him. He was like, yeah, I wish Nystrom would have thought I was beneath him too.
Yeah, you got to love Nystrom. He had no prejudice against
Bobby Nystrom. Was like, yeah, all right, you want to go? Fine, let's go.
Right. So anyway, so we're going to miss Clark Gilles. One of the things about Clark Gilles after the Islanders, you know, it's been 40 years almost, or it's actually, we're in the middle of the 40th anniversary of the four-year run, that he did a lot of things for the Islanders. You know, he'd show up, make appearances. You know, people still love him.
Yeah, I mean, he really became a Long Islander. I mean, he might be a Saskatchewan native, but if you ask Clark Gilles, like, where are you from, he would have said Long Island. He was here.
Yeah.
He was here for decades.
Yeah, and there were sometimes, and just one more thing, MSG used to do, like, you know, they'd find tapes and stuff and play them.
Yeah.
And one thing they found was the Islanders-Rangers game 2, I think it was, of the 75 series. I think it was that. It was one of the. It was. I know it was against the Rangers, but it was a coach's film. So it's bits and pieces. So they have to make a show out of it. And Clark Gilles would always get chosen for these things. So he'd be there.
Yeah.
And half the time, you can tell he didn't remember it all. But watching it, he would say, oh, there's Nystrom with the puck or something. And then he would start to remember it. So that was always fun to hear him think about the game, because he can't remember every game.
Some players have literally photographic memories, and they will remember almost every shift they ever took.
Yeah.
And others just get so lost in playing the games that they all just kind of blend. It all becomes one game. So, I mean, I'm kind of in the latter category, obviously not as a player, but as a sports writer. And if you show me either a story that I wrote, or if I see video of a game, I'll remember everything after I see it. But if you say, well, how about, you know, game two of the Subway Series with the Mets and the Yankees, I don't remember.
But by the way, I'm looking on NHL.com, and Dave Stubbs has written that Gilles died of cancer.
Ooh,
which I didn't know about.
I didn't know about. I don't know that anybody knew. Yeah. It wasn't out there that he had cancer.
No, but it's from an article from yesterday. Dave Stubbs was talking to Terry O'Reilly, and the quote is,
"Terry, did your face heal yet?"
He goes, "I knew Clark didn't want to deal with me, and I didn't want to deal with him." O'Reilly joked Saturday, but the nature of the game back then was fights would break out.
Terry O'Reilly, first of all, kicked Clark Gilles one time.
Yeah,
they had a fight. Terry O'Reilly kicked him. So, you know, yeah, did they have some famous fights? Yes, they did. Terry O'Reilly is a gutless punk.
Always has been.
All right. So, but those fights, and that was in 1980. Those fights, to me, those fights with Gilles and O'Reilly, that is what put the Islanders over the hump. And that those fights, because Clark Gilles, he beat Terry O'Reilly down. And my mook friend Croce's like, oh, Terry, nobody beat up Terry O'Reilly.
Oh, yeah.
Clark Gilles beat him. He beat him. And there was one fight that I saw, a friend of mine, Mark D'Amore, posted it on my Facebook page, that shows Clark Gilles and Terry O'Reilly going at it. But who went to his knees twice during the fight? Not Clark Gilles. Terry O'Reilly. I give him credit for getting back up and wanting more, but he got knocked down to his knees again.
Yeah.
All right? Clark Gilles, let me give you a second here, brother.
Okay.
Those fights showed the NHL, because the Bruins were a tough team back then. Very tough team. They had a lot of physical guys.
The battling Bruins.
Yeah, it was. They weren't quite the Flyers and those teams, the Broad Street Bullies.
But I also thought the Bruins were a little more dirty.
Than
the Flyers. Flyers would come in and try to start fights, but the Bruins would trip you.
Yeah.
Or nail you between the crotch or something.
Cross-check and, you know, spear and do everything. But those fights showed the NHL that, hey, we're not going to get pushed around anymore. And, yeah, we got skilled guys, and we got a lot of guys who can play the game, but now we got Clark Gilles, and he's a big dude, and he's not going to take it, and Bobby Nystrom's not going to take it, and you know, Gary Howitt was around still, I think, at that point, and they had a couple other guys who were tough guys, and hey, you're not going to be able to push us around the ice anymore. And that pretty much served notice to the rest of the NHL. And I think the rest of the NHL pretty much said to themselves, how are we going to beat these guys?
Right.
Because that's the only way we can do it, because they have so much talent up and down the lineup. We're not going to outskill them, and now we can't out-tough them. So buckle up, because the Islanders are going to win a few cups now.
Yep,
and that's what happened.
Yep. So anyway, so the Islanders did a nice tribute to them. Of course, they lost against the Maple Leafs, but they did a nice tribute to them at the new arena.
Saturday night.
Yeah, Saturday.
So. We're talking about the 80s, and you're jumping into 2021.
I jump around, brother.
Yeah.
So anyway, so just remembering, you know, one of the greats for the Islanders and in the NHL.
That's it. I had no idea that Clark Gilles had cancer.
Yeah, well, that's what Dave Stubbs wrote on NHL.com. So
I believe him. I mean, it's just so sad.
Yeah, so anyway, we're going to miss him. And
he's gone entirely too young.
And of course, one of the beautiful things about YouTube, brother, one more thing. If you ever want to find any fights, there's an obsession with people on YouTube, certain people, with posting fights. All you have to type in is Clark Gilles versus Terry O'Reilly fight. Clark Gilles versus Dave Schultz fight. You know, Bob Nystrom versus, you know, the entire team, whatever he was fighting.
Exactly.
That is the beauty of YouTube. And, you can
find a whole lot of fights, and you can find most, if not all, of the fights that Clark Gilles had with Terry O'Reilly.
Yeah, that's
beautiful. And you will see that I am right yet again, and my mook friend Croce has this condition called bias that doesn't allow him to remember things correctly.
Well, we should say your pal Croce, and he is my pal, is from Boston. He has that.
That's the problem. That's why I'm talking about the bias.
He has that Boston prejudice. You know, they have the T, not the subway. They have candlepin bowling, not regular bowling. You know, a little different. So
it's you know, he tries to defend his second class city and his second rate city, whatever you want to call it. Yeah, but it is what it is. So, but yeah, he was. You know, as usual, being the thread hijacker on my Clark Gilles thread when I posted that he had passed away, and I posted a little bit of a tribute and, you know, had some of my memory. Because this was a guy, Clark Gilles, who he was one of the heroes of my youth.
Yeah, definitely.
He was one of those guys that was, you know, for a teenager on Long Island, was you know, he was... A big influence and a big guy, and he was like
Islander teams from that time gave Long Island an image that it hasn't had since.
Exactly.
That
put Long Island on the map. That team.
Yeah, and you look over at the Coliseum, which is still standing. They haven't knocked it down yet, but it's become a parking lot for new cars for some dealership. I don't know. By the way, Clark Gilles had a foundation called the Clark Gilles Foundation, which is a nonprofit corporation developed to help children who are physically, developmentally, and or financially challenged. The goal of the foundation is to improve the quality of life, with 100% of the proceeds going straight to people in need. So if you're looking to maybe, remember Clark in your own way with money, donate to the Clark Gilles Foundation. He will definitely be missed. And, this is our youth becoming, old.
Like you said, the foundation has done a lot of good things for a lot of people, and that's who Clark Gilles was. I mean, he's a guy who universally loved by people. Everybody who has come in contact with him talks about what a gentleman he was.
Yep.
What a great sense of humor he had.
Yep.
He was a man's man, and they don't make them like that anymore. There really are few and far between, and it really is from an older generation, and people like that. It's like I said, they're getting harder and harder to find.
A couple of more things about Gilles, because there's so much to talk about. But he played 159 playoff games for the Islanders, scored 47 goals and 47 assists during those playoff games. He's one of the 17 Islanders that were part of the four straight Stanley Cup championships from 1980-1983.
Imagine that. 17 players.
Can't
even
that's
barely changed. That's how good those teams were.
Yeah.
And that's what a great job Bill Torrey did.
But also,
like, all right, we only need to just a little minor tweaks. That's all we need to do.
Yeah, but we have to say also that free agency and other things have changed. You know, you could see a couple of players maybe leaving earlier if they had the chance. But then again, you know what? If you know you're on a team that's that good, do you want to leave? You know,
some guys do. It depends.
I
tell you what.
I think Pedro Martinez, when he left the Red Sox for the Mets, yeah, he got more money. But Red Sox went in another 2 years or 3 years. He could have had another ring.
He left because he got a lot more money.
Yeah, but you know what?
Omar overpaid him to an extreme, but he had to. That's because that was what the Mets needed at the time.
But then again, you know, as a player, you want to be on the World Series. You want to win the World Series.
Yeah.
You want the ring. Do you take the money or do you say, okay, I have a better memory? He was horrible. I don't want to say he was horrible. He had one good season with the Mets. And the rest of it is
right, but that was one of the reasons why the Red Sox let him go. And again, we're getting off track here.
I know that, but anyway, one more thing, a couple more things about thing. He was also a member of the group that said we talked about this 19 straight playoff series wins, a mark that stands today, and as we said, will never be.
I can't see that
ever
being
changing.
Especially now, like you said, with the free agent era, and you couldn't keep a core together for that long and stay under the salary cap. It's pretty much impossible.
Yeah, you can't. And that's one of my problems with the salary cap. But anyway, that's the whole thing. Inducted into the NHL Hall of Fame in 2002. And his number hangs now in the UBS Arena, but it used to be in the Nassau Coliseum as they retired his number a while ago.
December 1996 was number 9 was retired.
Yeah, so... Anyway, let's talk about football. There was a lot of football yesterday and the weekend in general. As always, it seems like sometimes the playoff games are better than what might be in the Super Bowl. Though there has been the last 10 years some really good games, last second things where Seattle blows it or whatever. But anyway, let's start off with the Chiefs and the Bills. Truly a fantastic game. Truly a game if you're looking for a great football game and something you might want to watch again and again and again. It was that good.
It was an all-time game.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to sit here and be one of those knee-jerk people who says, it was the greatest game of all time. No. Come on.
Well, it's tough to tell, the day after. You have to let it marinate.
I know, but so many people are so desperate to call something the greatest of all time that they lose all perspective. What was it? Was it a great game? Yeah, it absolutely was. Will it be a game that goes down in history? Absolutely. Could it even at some point be considered one of the 10 greatest games of all time? Yeah, probably. It's got a shot for sure. But this game, the biggest problem, I'm going to start with the problem, is that the game goes to overtime.
Right.
And I saw somebody describe it, and this was the worst description. They said that the first 58 minutes wouldn't be talked about, but that the last 2 minutes of regulation, when both teams combined to score 25 points in less than 2 minutes,
incredible,
which was ridiculous, but he said that would be talked about forever. And I'm like, no, the first three quarters and three-plus quarters were good football. I was enjoying this game. It was back and forth. Here comes the Chiefs, and they're ready to pull away. And then here comes Josh Allen throwing a 75-yard bomb to make it 23-21. I'm like, here we go. This is a great game. Don't tell me it was barely worth any. What? It's like you got to be an idiot to describe it like that. But the problem that I had with this game, and it was the problem a lot of people had, only one team touched the ball in overtime.
Right.
And I understand. I understand the NFL's point with overtime, and it used to be if you won the coin toss, you were going to win overtime because all you had to do was kick a field goal. But now they changed the rule. I don't even know how many years ago to you have to score a touchdown. If you score a touchdown, then we're done.
Right.
And I'm like, at first I could accept it because it was like, all right, well, you got
well,
to stop him.
You know, it was better than the last one where if you got a field goal, it's over right there. So
that's what I just said.
I know that, but you know, to accept what how they changed it so you had to at least get a touchdown. But now we're at a different part. They really should change it so it's not sudden death anymore. This is a 1958 Baltimore Colts versus the Giants and all the mega game that that was. I personally think that at this point, seven minute periods, and whoever gets the most points in the 7 minutes wins the game. And if it's
I don't even know if I would say I would make it at least 10 because with 10 you got a better 7 minutes. One team could just drive the ball downfield and never you still have the other team would never touch it.
Well,
you could run 7 minutes off the clock fairly easily. My issue is twofold because yeah you can talk about it's not right that the Buffalo Bills never got to touch the ball in overtime.
Yeah.
But the other part of that is at some point you have to play some defense. The Kansas City Chiefs, first of all, the Bills screwed up. After they took the lead, the Chiefs had the ball with I think they were getting the ball back with 19 seconds left. Why did the Bills kick a touchback? Why not kick the ball to the 10 or the 5 or something? Keep the ball in the field. Because as soon as the returner touches the ball, the clock starts running.
Right, right.
The clock is your friend. The clock is your biggest friend at that point. Don't give them free 25 yards plus no time off the clock. That was stupid. I mean, that was just really absolutely dumb. I mean, in a situation like that, how do they not know, hey, we need the returner to touch the ball?
Yeah,
and if he breaks it for a touchdown, then, hey, good for him. But you need him running the ball and running time off the clock because chances are he's going to catch the ball and he's going to sprint out of bounds. But you know what? It's still going to take 3 or 4 seconds off the
right,
clock.
But I can see why they did it, which I wouldn't agree with. They think, oh, maybe he fumbles it and you know they get the ball back that way. But yeah, there's ways of holding the ball, you know?
But the point being that you're giving them not only the ball at the 25-yard line, but no time off the clock.
Right, I agree with that.
So you're basically giving them an extra play.
At least.
So, I mean, I just thought that was stupid. But here's Patrick Mahomes. Here's a pass. Here's a pass to Kelce. All of a sudden, now you're in field goal range. And here comes Harrison Butker, who's one of the couple of best field goal kickers in the NFL. 49-yard field goal. All right? It used to be a 50-yarder was 50-yarder. No way he's going to make that. Nowadays, it's almost automatic, especially for a lot of these guys. So Butker comes in, and they go from being down by a field goal with 19 seconds left to tying the game.
Right.
Play some defense. Don't just give him the pass. Don't let him get chunks of yardage where it's a 120-yard pass, 130-yard pass, and boom, now we got a field goal. Well, you had to play defense for 19 seconds. Play defense. And then the overtime, it was the same thing. They had 75 yards they went. They didn't the Bills supposedly had the best defense in the NFL this year. They certainly didn't look it on that drive because Patrick Mahomes carved them up. And either they were exhausted, which is one possibility, or they were playing this prevent defense, which, as we've said before, pretty much only ever prevents you from winning.
Right.
But again, Mahomes moved them downfield, did it pretty quickly. It was a very efficient drive. And then Travis Kelce makes a nice catch kind of out of his hip pocket in the end zone. Touchdown, game's over.
I agree. By the way, we got a message from one of our listeners, Phil Staros. He goes, good point, Rob and Tim. Both teams need a chance in overtime. And I think it should just be a timed out thing. I don't think it should be a thing where it's, you know, here's your chance. Because, you know, they sort of do that in college football. You know, they started at a certain...
Started at 25.
Yeah.
And then you just go back and forth.
Which I'm
not really a big fan of either because it's just you have to go to 25 yards.
Right.
And it leads to just score after score after score. It's almost the reverse of what we saw yesterday. It's the teams touch the ball too much.
Right.
So I think if you put 10 minutes on the clock and make it an overtime period, don't make it another quarter because you can't have five quarters anyway. but make it a 10-minute overtime.
Okay. Well.
Because a team would really have to control the ball to run 10 minutes off the clock. It's possible, but it's highly unlikely.
Right.
So put 10 minutes on the clock. You get one drive. Chances are the other team's going to get one drive. And then there might be another minute or two left. And then we'll see what happens. So whoever wins a coin flip is still going to take the ball first. But or maybe they don't. Maybe they let the other team take the ball and say, all right, let's see what they do. And then we know we're going to get the ball back. So, all right, now we know we're going to need a field goal to tie. We're going to need a touchdown
and
to win.
And you know, make it really, really fun. No taking the knee. You know, meaning that, you know, how a quarterback will take the knee and the game ends. You know, you can't do that. You have to keep going, so to speak. Yeah. That'd be a bit different. I mean, if you got to try for something.
If you're running it down the last 30 seconds, who cares?
Yeah, but it allows.
You earn that. Yeah. You earn that knee.
Yeah, but that way it prevents this whole, you know, losing 30 seconds, you know.
But that the point being that chances are 10 minutes is going to give you two drives.
Yeah. So yeah, you should get
so drives. That the second team wouldn't be taking a knee because they're going to have to do something with the ball. They're going to have to score points, so they're going to have, you know, they're going to have to score a field goal or a touchdown. They're going to have to do something.
No.
So, but you know, I mean, that was my issue. And like I said, the Bills supposedly had this great defense, and they certainly looked good earlier in the game. But again, I don't know if they were gassed. I don't know if they changed how they were playing. But the Chiefs carved them up in those last few minutes. It was ugly.
One thing that I think we've seen this year from the Bills is you know, they're going to be dominating the AFC East for the next couple of years.
I don't know about dominating. I mean, the Patriots were surprisingly good this year. Yeah. Mac Jones was pretty good. Yeah. The newest and youngest system quarterback for Bill Belichick, but. You know, we'll see. We'll see what the Patriots are able to put around them.
We know the Jets aren't going to do anything.
We'll see. The Jets have two number one draft picks, two top 10 draft picks. That's going to go a long way to improving them, but the Jets are probably still at least a couple years away.
Yeah. Anyway, the Bengals will be playing the Chiefs 3 p.m. on Sunday at Arrowhead Stadium. For the fourth consecutive season, the game will be played in the same place.
Yes.
At Arrowhead Stadium.
Ties an AFC record.
I hear, you know, it's a great place for get your ribs.
Barbecue
time.
Not the stadium, but you know, Kansas City in general.
No, but I'm talking about outside, actually for like tailgating. It's like one of the best places to get ribs.
Kansas City does barbecue.
You know, they do.
Phenomenal.
So, anyway, I want to take a break. We're going to come back and talk more about the NFL because it was a great weekend to watch these games, and that's the way it should be, you know. Will the Super Bowl be as good as this game we just saw yesterday?
Probably not.
Probably not, but you know what? We've said
football
that.
Football weekends don't get much better than the one we just experienced.
You know, still, you know, Bears-Giants, what, 86 was it? You know, the playoffs when the Giants won the first one with Parcells. I think it was Bears-Giants was one of the great games, too. And that wasn't the.
And the Bears-49ers, too.
Yeah, Bears-49ers. Anyway, we're going to take a break right now. You're listening to 90.3 WHPC. The voice of Nassau Community College from the press box is on your listening device. I'm Rob Leonard. He's Tim Leonard. As a matter of fact, I don't remember introducing us, brother. Well, but, you know, I think people know who we are.
Yeah, we're good.
Hey, we'll be back in 2 minutes.
Okay.
Yo.
Tell your friends about the Nassau Morning Madhouse. Hear what you're missing.
Check it out.
Let's get to the part where a song that you just would not want to hear over and over again.
All right. Don't Stop Believing. I hate that song.
Wow.
That song sucks. It's played at every stupid party and event. Like, no, shut up.
Easily, Mr. Brightside.
Really?
Mr. Brightside,
really?
But I hate that song. I hate that song.
Okay, so my song has always been...
Ben what? You cut out. Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Wait a minute. Ben what?
Wait. Yeah, okay.
Oh, my God. I hate Zoom.
That was unbelievable.
What do you think her answer is? Her answer is definitely going to be out of left field.
It's something we all love, I guarantee you.
The Nassau Morning Madhouse. Weekday mornings from 7 to 9.
Yeah.
On the voice of Nassau Community College.
90.3 WHPC.
Girl.
Catching up after work.
Guys, this round's on me.
Right? What? You stupid.
You said that? You really said that?
I knew you should have just.
should have just seen them. Like, you should have been.
Getting back to the moments we miss starts with getting informed. Get the latest info about COVID-19 vaccines at getvaccineanswers.org. It's up to you. Brought to you by the Ad Council.
All hit music.
For all those songs radio has forgotten about, join me, Big Ed, Mondays from 10 a.m. till noon for the Good Gold Show. We'll bring back all the great hits of the 50s, 60s, 70s, and more. The sounds of doo-wop to disco, all the Motown, soul, and great rock and roll. We'll even take your requests and dedications to the Good Gold Show.
Music.
On the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC, and streaming on the iHeartRadio app.
WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. Playing now is Marching On by The Alarm. I was watching, I still haven't found what I'm looking for, brother, the video on Friday.
Yes.
And there is an Alarm fan in the video.
Yeah, wearing Bono. An Alarm.
No, not a Bono. A guy
Bono's
wearing
an Alarm fan.
Wearing, some guy wearing an Alarm shirt.
Yeah, I saw it. I know.
Yeah, so I don't think you have that shirt, brother. You have all the others. It's a nice plain white
shirt. It's an older shirt. Yeah. It's in that video, but I don't know. I might have had it.
Yeah. So anyway, so
back in the day.
Back in the day. So we talked about the Chiefs and the Bills. By the way, if you would like to call in, please do. 516-572-7440. Let's talk about the Rams and Buccaneers. Buccaneers lost. Everyone's asking if Tom Brady's going to retire. I don't think he is. There's a.
I'm pretty sure he's out of contract, isn't he?
I'm not sure, but he can sign.
Check that on Google or something. Because I thought when he got to the Buccaneers,
I think it was a 2-year deal.
It was a 2-year. I know it was a 2-year deal. I don't remember if he ever extended it, or you know if they reworked the salary or did anything like that. I don't remember if any of that happened. But you know, and will the Buccaneers want to sign him to another deal? You can't sign anybody to a 1-year deal anymore. It's just not possible.
Well, you can.
Somebody like Brady won't go to one. Brady's not Ryan Fitzpatrick. I mean, you know, if you're going to sign Brady, you got to sign him to a 2-year deal. You got to spread the money out.
Yeah, but he might not want. He might just want to say, "I only want one more year."
Yeah, but that's why you spread the money out, because then he'll still get the money, but it's spread out and it's more cap friendly for the team. Instead of giving him $25 or $30 million to play in 2023, or I guess 2022, really, when it comes down to it. You're spreading the money over 2 years,
right?
And this way, instead of it being $30 million on 1 year, it'll be like 17 and 17. So right. It makes it more cap friendly for the Bucks, and they can do
well.
They
it
can
says
do more.
Here that his contract details, according to some relief here, it said $25 million in 2020. 2021 was supposedly $41 million.
Yeah,
but 2022, which is next year, $8.9 million.
So, that would obviously have to be reworked.
Yeah, but you know what? It's not like he needs the money.
No,
but maybe he delays it or gets a, a personal services contract. I don't know, but
they don't do that. That's called circumventing the salary cap.
Well, that's what I would do. But I think he's going to play at least one more year. You know, he wants to hang out with his boy Gronk.
But does Gronk want to play? I mean, there's a lot of decisions. I mean, first of all, when you talk about the Buccaneers, a lot of guys took less money to come back this year to have one more go-round with Brady. And
I would.
It's the whole thing about, you know, putting a band back together. And can you do it again and ask professional athletes to go another year of taking less than what they could make? It's one thing to do it for 1 year and say, all right, let's try to win back-to-back Super Bowls. Well, what's the motivation for next year?
To win another one.
There is no motivation. The motivation is, will you have a good team? Yes. Will the majority of your team be 2 years older than it was when you won the Super Bowl? Yes.
Well,
so that is the issue. And you know, I don't know. Leonard Fournette want to take a lower salary than what he could get from some other teams? I don't know what Mike Evans' contract situation is. But, you know, he's got to be close.
You know, I don't. I'm not sure where Gronk is. I'm sure he's probably on 1 year deals at this point. But you know, all of these guys are going to require raises, and you're going to have to figure it out at some point. Obviously, you need to keep the offensive line as much intact as possible because those are the guys keeping Brady upright. And at 44 or 45 years old, Brady can't afford to get knocked around.
No, but he hasn't gotten knocked around all his career.
Because so he throws the ball. It's quick release.
Hey, I would do that too.
And that was why the Rams were able to beat. And this was I saw this coming with this game. And that's why I actually picked the Rams to win that game. Because I saw the pass rush. Anytime a team can get to Brady, Brady gets rattled. The Giants did it to him in the Super Bowl.
That's true.
And very few teams have been able to do it because it's all three-step and five-step drop with him. He's not going 60 yards down the field for the most part. It's quick hits. It's 6 yards. It's 5 yards. It's 7 yards. And it's, you know, they slowly march down the field. And you know, I've been saying it until I'm blue in the face on the show. I don't know why other teams don't do the same thing. But Brady has been doing it for 20 years. So,
right.
But if you saw yesterday, Von Miller and Aaron Donald, both of them had 7 pressures. They both got to Brady. Von Miller whacked him at one point, hit him with the helmet. Brady's lip was bleeding. I don't know if he bit his lip and cut it, but you could see the blood. And Brady was incensed with the referee. Got the first unsportsmanlike conduct call of his career. That's how hot Brady was. He was angry. He was all screaming about it. But you know what? It was a good play. Shake him up a little bit. Make him you know let him know you're there, as I said in Slapshot. But that was the key to the game. And I thought it was going. That was why. The Rams acquired Von Miller was exactly for a game like yesterday, so that if they played Tom Brady, they would have two guys. It wouldn't just be Aaron Donald, because one guy can get double teamed and you can neutralize him. But when you have one guy coming from each side, you can't get both of them. So one of them will get to Brady. And like I said, 7 pressures each yesterday. That's a huge number. So They were in Brady's grill for most of the game.
Right.
And Brady's not used to that.
No, and I think that's always been his problem. That he, you know, as you said, he 3 steps and back, throw it
quick.
And I think that's always been my problem with him. Yeah, he's won all those Super Bowls, but if you just did the 3 steps and back and go for 6 yards and 6 yards and 6 yards. Well, you know,
that's why I call him a system quarterback. And like, you know, don't call in and scream at me and think that I'm disrespecting Brady. Brady is clearly one of the great quarterbacks who's ever played the game. But I'll take other guys over him as quarterbacks.
Sure.
Brady runs a system and it's what he does. And he does it really well. Don't get me wrong. But in terms of quarterbacks, I'll take Aaron Rodgers. I'll take Brett Favre. Give me. I like gunslinger types.
Yeah.
Give me a guy like that. Give me Dan Marino. Give me somebody who's not afraid to take a hit and launch a 50-yard pass.
Joe Namath.
I'll take those other guys over Joe Namath.
Well, yeah.
I'll take 1969 Joe Namath.
Yeah, well, but he got hit all the time.
Oh, that was the problem. But give me some of those guys. Give me Terry Bradshaw.
Yeah.
All right. Somebody like that, and I'll be more than happy.
Roger the Dodger. Roger Staubach.
Yeah, so him too.
He was always good with the two-minute warning.
Exactly. The two-minute drill, you mean.
Two-minute warning. I call it the two-minute warning. Anyway, brother.
But the Rams-Buccaneers, brother, this game, 27-3, the Rams led.
Right.
And as soon as that score happened, all of a sudden people started talking about the Falcons and the Patriots from the Super Bowl. When Brady came back from 28-3 and the Patriots eventually won. And all of a sudden, the game shifted. 27-6, 27-13, 27-20, and then 27-27. And meanwhile, the Rams couldn't hold on to the ball.
Nope.
Fumble. They lost 4 fumbles, including...
How do you lose 4 fumbles?
Including a shotgun snap that Matthew Stafford never even called for. The ball went zipping past his left ear. And he didn't see it until it was past him. And then two linemen came over, jumped on the ball, and I'm like, what? I mean, the Rams seem to just desperately want to hand this game over to the Buccaneers. Desperately wanted to do it. And then finally, and this to me was the greatest part of all. Here's 27-27, and you're thinking, all right, we're going overtime because there's like 40-something seconds left in the game. But what happens? Matthew Stafford pulls a Tom Brady. Mm-hmm. He says, all right, I got enough time to run some plays. Here's a pass to Cooper Kupp for 20. Here's a pass over the top to Cooper Kupp, and all of a sudden, ball's on the 13-yard line. Thank you very much. We're kicking a field goal. Matt Gay, get out there and kick a 30-yarder. And the Rams do to Brady what Brady's been doing to teams his entire career. I love that.
Yeah, well.
Loved it.
Gets a nice little revenge there on him.
So now we got we got the Rams will be playing host to the San Francisco 49ers Sunday at 6:30. That's the second game of the doubleheader.
Right. Interesting that game is because Los Angeles, you know, they built a stadium and they put the Rams in there.
Right.
You know, the return of the Rams. But you know what? In Los Angeles, football is still not the big story the way it should be. You know, they have two teams now, and there seems to be, you know, oh, okay, the Rams are doing well, or the Chargers, you know, are doing whatever they do. And it's kind of strange how they built this new stadium. They bring back two teams that started out in L.A., and the love there is not what you think it should be.
True.
One more thing about Tom Brady. If he were to come back next year, he would be the oldest starting quarterback ever. He'd be 45 years old. So that could be something he shoots for.
He's in shape. I mean, I think his decision is going to depend on how much or what the Buccaneers can assemble and what kind of team they can put together. I think if the Buccaneers team looks similar to what they had this year, and if they can get a lot of those guys back and get some younger guys too, and get some, you know, make some improvements, I think Brady will come back and give it at least one more shot. But otherwise, if he doesn't like what he sees, and if some of the linemen disappear, and you know Gronk decides he's had enough, and they don't have receivers, I could certainly see Brady saying, you know what, I'm not going shopping for another team.
Yeah.
Because I'm 45, nobody's going to want to give me a deal. I mean, let's face it, even though he's Tom Brady, I don't know how many teams want to invest in a 45-year-old quarterback.
Hey, if he were to say to the Bucs, or the Bucs say to him, we don't need you, or thank you. If I'm the Jets, I'm signing for 2 years. Yes, I am.
No.
Yes, you are.
Why?
Because you need
a Zach Wilson.
Yeah, and I'll tell you who's doing should.
I'll tell you who should sign him. The Giants. Never mind the Jets.
Either one.
The Giants are in a transition with Daniel Jones, who has done nothing but underachieve for 3 years now. I'm giving Zach Wilson time to develop and time to be the guy, because Zach Wilson has actually shown that he can play the position. Yeah. Daniel Jones has shown me nothing over 3 years, except that he can fumble.
I would either team. If I was either team, I'd sign him.
If I'm the Giants, I'd do that in a heartbeat, because the Giants would actually be somewhat attractive to Brady, I think, because they had a lot of weapons on offense. You know, you got well, Sterling Shepard will be a free agent, but you got Galladay, you got Saquon, you got Kadarius Toney, the rookie from this year. I'm missing somebody, but there's a decent number of weapons. You got Evan Ingram at tight end. So the line is shaky, though. They would have to upgrade the line in the draft or by free agent.
If Brady were to come, he'd say, I need a couple of more line guys.
Yeah, he would, for sure. But, well, you know, and to do that, the Giants would have to make some painful cuts, because they don't have the cap space to go out and hit the free agent market. The money's just not there.
Yeah, that's true. Anyway, I'm going to skip around a little bit, brother, because we're running out of time. The Rangers are retiring Henrik Lundqvist's number on Friday.
How about that?
Number 30. Does he deserve to have his number retired?
Absolutely. One of the greats, brother. One of the greats.
I agree.
He was a Ranger, so I didn't like him, but you got to respect the accomplishments. What a phenomenal goalie. Just what an outstanding career. This guy, he kept Ranger seasons alive by himself.
Yes,
a lot.
Definitely. We should say right now the Rangers, with 42 games played, are leading the Metropolitan Division with 58 points. Matter of fact, they are the second best team in the whole league. Colorado has 59. The Islanders, who
they were third.
Oh, I'm sorry, you're right.
Lightning.
I'm sorry. Florida, yes. And Tampa Bay have 61 points. So,
there you go.
You know, so, and the Islanders now are seventh in the Metropolitan Division.
Moving up.
But they've played the least amount of games with 34. Philadelphia is slowing down, as I expected them to. But the Islanders still, you know, you can't.
The Flyers have been a disaster for about the last month and a half.
Yeah. And the Islanders right now, for a while, they were starting to get into that mood where they were winning games that they should be winning. And
they are. The Islanders,
I'm not going
by memory. I think they're like 7-1-2 in their last 10.
They are.
Unless you got a stat
10,
there.
Last 10, 7-2-1, yeah.
Yeah, so our 7-2-1 then.
Yeah.
Because the Toronto loss.
Right.
But they're playing well. Yeah. I mean, but they need to play like that the rest of the season.
Yeah. 7-2-1.
Because if you look at the Islanders right now, with all the games in hand that they have, they are going to pass the Devils and the Columbus Blue Jackets in probably within the next week or two. It's going to happen.
Well, the Islanders have 34 points, Devils 35, Columbus 37.
Right. But then you get to the Washington Capitals, who are in fourth place. The Islanders have 8 games in hand on Washington, but they're 21 points behind them.
So they got to get it a little better.
So do the math. Even if the Islanders win every one of those games, they're still 5 points behind the Capitals.
Right. One more thing, brother. It's not something we planned on talking about, but I quickly want to bring it up since we brought up Henrik Lundqvist's retirement. The Mets have announced that they're going to retire Keith Hernandez's number.
Didn't we mention that a couple weeks ago?
No, we didn't.
We didn't?
You know, it happened after our show. I'm trying to figure out.
It was one of those Monday noon things.
Yeah.
Thanks, Mets.
I'm trying to figure out if his number should be retired.
I personally don't think so, because he played half his career with the Mets. This is the same reason why I didn't think the Yankees should retire Reggie Jackson's number. But I think if you're going to retire somebody's number, I think that player should play more than just the majority, because I think Hernandez played, I think it was 10 out of 17 seasons with the Mets, if and again, I'm going by memory here. But
7 seasons with the Mets.
All right, so you see even fewer.
Oh, by the way, I get this, brother. I'm looking at the stats for Keith, and you know what they've done now? You know, his last season was for the Indians.
Right.
It now says the Guardians.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it should say Indians, parentheses, 1990.
You know, no, don't get so obsessed about this stuff,
brother. I'm just do.
But anyway, so I mean, he played less than half his career with the Mets.
Yeah.
And was an important player for them? Yes, he was.
Yeah.
But why did they wait so long if retiring his number was such a priority?
And if you're going to do that, what about Darryl Strawberry, who was – why not?
No.
He was here for 8 years. He had great numbers while he was here.
And left in anger and disgrace.
Sure.
Was – Part of the drug culture of those Mets. And so was Hernandez. That's another reason why I don't think they should retire his
number.
Well,
we don't know that. But anyway.
We do know that. He admitted it.
Well, that.
Pretty much.
Not with the Mets. I think that was with the St. Louis Cardinals. So.
And where do you think that culture came from?
I don't know.
All right.
So anyway, I'm not sure. I mean, if you look at his number, I mean, the leadership qualifications that he brought
absolutely
to the Mets.
Big
and,
time.
And, you know, they don't win in 86 without him.
I don't know about that.
I do.
Let's not go that crazy.
I think so. I think he brought a different attitude to the Mets, which hadn't been there before.
Well, he and Gary Carter. I mean, it's, you know, both of them. But yeah, I mean, he was undoubtedly the leader of that team. There's no questioning that.
But yeah, I also sometimes think like the Cowboys. They don't sometimes they'll put this, you know, the star, you know what's
the Ring of Honor
thing, yeah. But they don't retire the number. Because they've had
right. I mean, that's and that's how I think Hernandez should be remembered as a Met. I think he should be remembered as an important part of the franchise. But I don't think you make him an immortal member of your franchise.
And one thing I think maybe why they're doing this, firstly, he's been one of the announcers,
right,
you know, the best announcing team in baseball. Him, Darwin,
probably
Gary Cohen,
probably.
But there is a chance that he could go into the Hall of Fame.
No,
You don't think so?
No.
Why not?
No. It's just he's not a Hall of Famer.
Come on, brother.
He is a very good player.
How many Golden Gloves?
Very good player.
I would put him in a second.
You're a Met fan.
No, not just that for reason. Though his numbers, he had 2182 on the hits. His batting average.
Yeah, low.
Yeah, well, what do you want from me?
I want you to make an argument and then give me something to go on.
Okay, I'm looking.
When you say 2,182 hits and then you agree with me when I say that's low, well, you're acknowledging that he's not a Hall of Famer.
Batting average 296.
Okay, good for him.
I would put him in there.
How many home runs did he hit?
That's different. He was a first baseman.
Yeah, that's a power position.
162.
Please, stop. Stop. You're embarrassing yourself.
162. Didn't he actually
put him in the Mets Hall of Fame? How about that? All right.
Well, that's true.
He doesn't belong in the Baseball Hall of Fame.
I think.
Like I said, very good player, very good leader. But Hall of Fame, no. And plus, like you said, the drug issue with the Cardinals and what. No. Sorry, Keith.
I think he's going in.
No, it's not happening.
I think he'll go in eventually.
No.
If you could put in Bill Mazeroski and Phil Rizzuto, you know.
Bill Mazeroski basically was put in because, number one, he was an outstanding defensive player, and yes, Keith Hernandez was too, but Bill Mazeroski hit one of, if not the greatest home run in baseball history. I shouldn't say that because Bobby Thompson was the greatest. But Bill Mazeroski was up there in the top 10 of greatest home runs
Bill's
ever
was
hit.
In the World Series.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, and again, it was against the Yankees. And it won a World Series with the Pirates, who never should have won that World Series.
I know that.
So, but that's why Bill Mazeroski, and I still say Bill Mazeroski tried to give one of the great Hall of Fame speeches ever. The man was just completely overcome with emotion. It was beautiful.
So, anyway, I think he'll be it. But I also think if he goes in the World's in the Hall of Fame, he'll want the Mets want him to go in as a Met. So, I think that's part of it. What else do we have here?
Quickly, brother, I'm going to mention
4 minutes.
Ayoka Lee of Kansas State set an NCAA Division I women's basketball record by scoring 61 points yesterday against I think it was Oklahoma. Also NCAA related, John Stockton, the former Utah Jazz great and Gonzaga great, has had his college basketball tickets at Gonzaga revoked because he refuses to wear a mask at games. John Stockton is a COVID idiot.
I can see not wearing a mask at the games.
John Stockton claims falsely, I will say this is falsely, that 150 professional athletes have been killed by the vaccine.
Well, he's being
that is a blatant lie.
That's a blatant lie. But you know what? Sometimes you have to take your mask off. You know.
No.
Yes, you do.
John Stockton, boo. I wanted to mention soccer, brother.
Quickly.
Tottenham on Wednesday had the greatest comeback possibly in Premier League history. They scored two goals, the first of which was in the 95th minute, stoppage time, the second in the 97th minute. So they went from losing 2-1 and an almost certain loss to a 3-2 victory with a pair of goals by Steven Bergwijn within 80 seconds of each other. Snatching victory from the jaws of defeat.
That's always a good thing to
say. Tottenham Hotspur.
That's always a good thing to say.
And former Tottenham attacking midfielder Eric Lamella won the Puskas Award, which is awarded each year for the greatest goal scored in that calendar year from all over the world.
Really?
It's the second year in a row a Tottenham player has won it, brother, because Heung-min Son won it last year.
Was it as great as my goal when I was playing in 11th grade and I shot a half-field goal at John J. Burns Park?
That would have been up for contention, brother, but you probably wouldn't have won.
I'm sorry to hear that. Okay, well, you know, that's good to know. Just a reminder, brother, our good friend Steve Mandracina, who does not believe that podcasts happen after you do a live show.
They do.
He's almost like an anti-podcaster, if you think about it.
He's like the John Stockton of podcasts.
He is. I can't believe it. Anyway, he hosts a show here at the station called Everything and Anything, where he tries to play Everything and Anything in a two-hour show every Friday at 6 p.m., and he plays the lost hits and misses from the rock era, along with hits from obscure artists and forgotten songs by rock and roll superstars, as well as music from current hitmakers. That is Everything and Anything every Friday at 6 p.m. right here on 90.3 WHPC. Coming up next, they call him Big Ed for many reasons.
That's what I call him.
But that's what I call him, too. I can't call him Little Ed. It's like Little Enos. You know, Little Enos and Big Enos. He's Big Enos, and I don't know who would be the Little Enos. You know? Anyway, he's coming up next with his show called Good Gold. So keep it tuned here to WHPC. My name is Rob Leonard. Thank you for listening. Brother, thank you for being on the show as always, because I couldn't do the show without you.
I live for this, brother.
I know you do. I'll see you Friday with Beatles Songs at 8 p.m. And thank you for listening. And this will be a podcast later on. Take care and bye-bye.